Hello, sweet friends. Thank you so much for stopping by. My name is Becky, and welcome to Kinda Shabby. Each week, I share kinda shabby but always chic crafty inspirations. In today's video, I have two short and sweet projects to share with you. I am participating in an upcoming vendor market, so I am happily crafting away. And one of my best sellers at the markets has always been my door hangers. So, I'm going to walk you through the steps of how I go from just a round 18-inch piece of wood to a beautiful, best-selling door hanger. I'm also going to be sharing with you my recipe for making your own chalk paint using Plaster of Paris. So let's go ahead and get these projects started. Making your own chalk paint is actually very easy. 15 years ago, when it wasn't readily available, I made my own chalk paint all the time. But then I got used to picking it up at Walmart or any other craft store, and even your Home Depot and Lowe's, places like that also began carrying chalk paint. Now I'm having trouble finding good white chalk paint, so we're just going to make our own. And my recipe is as easy as 1, 2, 3. You start with 1 cup of paint, and I use the Rust-Oleum Ultra Cover Flat White. Then you have 2 teaspoons of your Plaster of Paris and 3 teaspoons of hot water. Now I realize 3 teaspoons does equal a tablespoon, but it helps to remember 1, 2, 3. So you're going to take 2 teaspoons of your Plaster of Paris, and you're going to mix that into your 3 teaspoons of your hot water. And you're just going to thoroughly mix that until that is dissolved. And then once that is dissolved, you're going to pour that into your 1 cup of paint and thoroughly mix that as well. And it does take a couple of good stirs to make sure that all of that Plaster of Paris is incorporated into your base paint. And then this for me is a good consistency. All right, so let's go ahead and I'll get this put away and we'll start painting on our door hanger. The wood that I'm using is called luan, and we pick this up at either Lowe's or Home Depot. And you can see that it is very thin, nice and lightweight. And this is the birch luan. I prefer this because it has a nice tight grain in there. And then he also has cut 2 holes for me to put my jute twine in to serve as my hanger. I always start on the back and dip my bristles in a little bit of water. And we'll start with our paint. And you can see just how good our chalk paint looks already. And if you need to add a little water to your paint, you can. It's very normal for you, especially after it's left open and you're using it for a couple of minutes, for it to start to get a little thicker, and you just add more water to it. So I'm going to do 2 coats on the back and 2 coats on the front. And while my paint is drying, I am cutting out the stencil vinyl pieces that I'll need to take over to my Silhouette Cameo and cut for my stencils. And I use the Aura Mask 813 to cut out all of my stencils. After I cut my stencil, I use my weeding tool, and I also use a large safety pin to weed out the insides of the letters for my stencil. I also keep a lint roller close by because that makes it easy after you've pulled those centers out to just stick it on there. So this is the top portion of my stencil, and now I need to put my transfer tape on there. And I use the Transfer Right Ultra. And then I just rub over it to make sure I've got good adhesion between my transfer tape and my stencil vinyl. And before I pull it off my mat, I always mark the middle because that makes it easier for me to line it up on top of my door hanger. I like to turn my mat over and remove the mat from the stencil. It's just easier to pull it off that way. At least it is for me. And there we go, first half is done.
And I have the bottom part cut and weeded. And now I just need to put my transfer tape on that and mark the middle. But that's going to be really, really cute when we get that on our rounder. So our paint is dry and it looks fantastic. And I did end up putting 3 coats on the front. I also want to show, kind of hard to see on camera, but there is a sediment here after I've let my brush sit in the water. So you're going to need either some cheesecloth, a piece of burlap, some tulle that has been folded over on itself a couple of times, something for you to put over and dump that water out that's going to catch that sediment. You do not want to put that down your sink. I'm going to come and add some more cute rustic appeal to this by using my Iron Orchid Designs barnwood planks. This is a set of a bunch of different wood look textures, and I just love using them on my rounders because it gives that wood planked look. If you do not have these stamps, you most certainly could just take a ruler and then draw in some lines and paint over those to make it have the appearance of planked wood. So I have my stamp here on my quilt ruler, and I love using these because they're nice and long, and it gives me a nice handle when I'm working with these larger stamps. And I'm also using black permanent ink. And I'm going to tap my stamp pad onto my stamp, and I'm going to start in the middle, place it down, and walk my hands over the stamp. And you can see that's just a very faint impression of a wood plank. Then I'm going to put just a little more ink on this side, line it up to complete the plank on this side, ink this side, and complete the plank on this side. And there's one of our planks done. Isn't that nice? And I'm just going to go and follow that same process to complete the rest of my board. And then I'm going to take it outside and lightly go over it with some sandpaper and make that a softer background. Because there is plaster of Paris in my paint, I will be wearing a mask to make sure I do not inhale any of the paint particles. And you can see after sanding that that just gives it such a nice soft effect there for the background of our rounder. And now it's time to put our stencil on. And I always start with the bottom. If you don't have a silhouette or a Cricut to cut stencils, I am going to be showing how you can achieve a similar look using carbon paper. So I like using my quilt ruler to find the middle, and I'm just going to round off these corners here and trim away the excess so I can get it closer to the edge. And I want my A and my E to be about a half inch away from the edge of my rounder. Now I'm going to tape down half of it. Then I'm going to peel away the paper backing, cut that away, lay that over. Remove the paper from the other side, smooth that down, and then I take my scraper and go over my letters. Then I remove the clear transfer tape. I pull it back on itself, and I always save my transfer tape because it is reusable. And then I take my fingers and just gently rub all around the letters to make sure everything is adhered well. Then I always pick it up and kind of hold it at an angle and look down on it. That way, if there's any bubbles, I can see that. And then I come back with painter's tape. I'm using the Waverly in the color ink to actually do my stenciling with. And I just pour out a little bit on a tile, work off paint, because you don't want your brush to be too loaded. And then I prefer a stippling up and down motion. After I get to the end, this will be dry, and then I'll go back over it again with a second coat. Deciding when to pull your stencil up is actually personal preference. You can see I've got my 2 coats on there,
Some areas are kind of dry, some areas are still a little wet, and that's when I prefer to pull up my stencil. So I'm going to remove my painter's tape, and since my grain is running this way, I pull my stencil the opposite of the direction of the wood grain. And I'm not pulling straight up, I'm pulling it back against itself. And that helps to also eliminate the possibility of splinters. Because sometimes no matter how well the wood is sanded, it's still going to pull up a splinter or two. Then I'm going to come back in with a large safety pin and I will pull up the middle of those letters. You want to just get up underneath the edge of that stencil vinyl there and lift that up. And now we're going to go ahead and put the second part of our stencil on. And again, I'm going to find my center. And then I also want to make sure that I'm not going to overlap those letters. Tape down one side. Remove the paper backing. And come to the other side. And smooth that down. Take my scraper tool and rub over my letters. And I'm going to be careful not to rub too hard. I don't want to pull the paint up on what I've already done. And now I'm going to pull off my clear transfer tape. And again, I pull it back on itself and not straight up. And then take my fingers and go all over those letters just to make sure I have good adhesion. Give it a little side eye to make sure I don't have any bubbles. I'd just rather be safe than sorry. So I'm just going to add my painter's tape. And again, up and down stippling motion. And two coats on, and it's getting that nice little, some of it's wet, some of it's dry look that I like. So it's time to pull the stencil. So we're going to carefully remove our painter's tape. And because this is still a little wet, I don't want to pull the stencil up this way because I don't want to risk getting this messed up. So I'm just going to pull the stencil up that way. And then go in with my safety pin and just pull those up. So I'm just going to take my time and finish removing all of this excess vinyl. And that is looking really good so far. So after everything dried, I took them outside and gave them multiple coats of this Rust-Oleum Matte Clear. Now, let's go ahead and move on to how to do a similar sign using your carbon paper. Back before I had a silhouette, I used this method when I made signs. I would also use something similar. I would print out on cardstock a design that I liked. Then I would take my X-Acto knife and cut out to make my own stencils. So you've got a couple of different ways to achieve a very similar look without having to have a silhouette or a Cricut. And this is just for demonstration purposes, so I just grabbed a piece of scrap wood out of the garage and put a little bit of paint on it. Now I'm going to take my carbon paper, and then you want to put the darker side down. Take your sign and put that on top, and then you're just going to tape that all into place. Then you're going to take an ink pen, or I've got a tracing tool here to use, and you are just going to follow the outline of your design, transferring that carbon paper onto your painted surface below. And before you remove everything, you just want to pull it back and check to make sure that you have a complete design and that you did not forget to trace around any areas. I haven't done this technique in many, many years, and you can see I've overdrawn, my hand's not steady anymore, but it's an easy fix with just touching up with some paint. Now the next step is to take either a Sharpie paint pen, or you can use some actual paint to fill in your areas. First tracing and then filling in. So
so you can see it's not terrible, but I would definitely need to practice before I started doing this method again. So now let's move on and get some florals on our door hangers. So looking through my florals, I decided I'm going to do lamb's ear, lavender, and some cotton on this one, ivy and hydrangea on this one, and I made this one without the planked background, and I'm going to do eucalyptus and a buffalo check bow on this one. First, I'm going to put my hanger on. I've got a 24-inch long section of some thick jute rope, and I've put blue painter's tape on the end, and I'm just going to thread that through those holes and tie a knot. Just like that, and that's going to form our hanger. I like that arrangement there, so I'm just going to go ahead and get this glued in. I think that is going to be a really pretty accent to the top of this sign. I think that looks fantastic. I love the lavender and lamb's ear combination, and I use just a lamb's ear garland that I pick up from Hobby Lobby when it's on sale, and then I use the lavender picks and also the cotton I get from Walmart. And after I lay in my pieces of my garland, I then go back and just cut some extra little leaves and just tuck those in to fill in any bare spots, and it just looks so good. So let's go ahead and get this one assembled. This is a very large bloom, and I can't just glue that down as a whole. I'm just going to take my scissors and clip these apart. And now we've got all of these little blossoms that we can glue on there. And that is going to give us a better look than trying to glue this whole piece on. I've selected these two pieces here, and I'm just going to glue those down, again, following the outline of my door hanger. Then I will take these extra pieces here and just fill in any blank spots. As I'm cutting the leaves off of these branches, I do like to leave like this little section right in here. And that just gives me a nice little area to put my glue on without fear of it melting away. So I've filled all that in, and that looks really good. I won't be using all of these pieces, so I'm actually going to be able to get two hydrangea door hangers out of this one bloom. But I'm going to tuck those pieces in just to see how I like it before I glue it down. There ain't nothing like a blue hydrangea. Isn't that gorgeous? So I like how that looks, and I'm going to go ahead and just glue it all into place. And for extra stability, I'm going to come back in and just tack down some of these hydrangea blooms to the leaves, just so it's not going to go anywhere. And now we have this one finished. I did tuck in some more leaves up underneath there. I think that is just gorgeous. I love it. For our last door hanger, I'm going to be taking pieces of my eucalyptus garland that I pick up at Hobby Lobby. I will be doing the same process of gluing these around on the outside of my rounder, and then coming back in and filling in. And then we'll come back and make our bow. So I've left the middle open for my bow, and then we can go back in and add more greenery after we get that in place. I have several different bow tutorials on my channel, but for this particular bow, you're going to need 3 pieces of wired ribbon cut at 20 inches long, and then you'll need either a pipe cleaner or a zip tie. We'll also be cutting another piece of our ribbon for the center. You're going to slightly overlap your pieces, and you're going to glue those ends together to form a loop. Just like that, and then you're going to do that to all 3 pieces. Then make sure your seam is in the middle and flatten your 3 loops like this. And then you're going to scrunch up your loops. So I like to have 2 loops like this, and then I take the 3rd loop, but but it's going to be placed on top of the other two. And then you'll take your pipe cleaner and put it in the middle. Then you can twist it and tighten it all down. I think I want some tails on this one. And I cut my tail 14 inches long. So I'm going to fold this in half. And then when you fold it again, you're going to cut at an angle from the fold toward that edge. And now I can scrunch this up and place that in my pipe cleaner and twist and tie that on as well. And then take my wire cutters and just clip that off and just glue that down. And now we'll need another piece of our ribbon. And this piece is 6 inches long, and now I'm just going to fold it in over itself so it's thinner, like this. This is going to be placed in the middle of our ribbon, wrapped around like that. Now I can glue this first section down. And now I can trim off this excess and glue that down. And now we're just going to place that on a rounder, make sure it's centered, and glue that down. And I am very generous with that glue. And we're going to press firmly and hold until it sets. And then come back and fluff out all of our ribbon. And then I'm just going to come back in, add in a little more eucalyptus to fluff and fill that up. I just love the way these little rounders turn out. Now, I sell mine for $42. You may be able to sell yours more. You may have to sell yours for less, depending on your area. Now, all I need to do is give you guys a closer look at how lovely all of our beautiful door hangers turned out. Thank you so much for stopping by today, and I hope you enjoyed these door hanger projects. Please remember to subscribe for more kinda shabby but always chic crafty inspirations. And until next week, my sweet friends, be blessed.